So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
What is balance? It's the nation's second largest financial center. It's more flights per capita than any other U.S. region. It's leading the nation in fundraising for the arts. It's Charlotte, USA. Envision your business here. Charlotte, USA. Life in balance.
The mountains around Salt Lake City, Utah will soon welcome 80 nations from around the world. Thousands of athletes and millions of spectators will gather here to compete and celebrate the 2002 Winter Olympics. For 17 days, these mountains will be the world's athletic stage, but they were once host to a very different kind of drama, one that involved freedom and survival over 150 years ago for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
The saints came for a religious reason, because of freedom of religion, their faith, their development, their spiritual development.
There's a kind of interesting metaphor here. This is the Great Basin. The waters here don't even mingle with waters on the outside. And that seemed to be exactly what Brigham Young was hoping for at the time. He wanted isolation, a chance to build his vision of the kingdom of God without interference or opposition, as they had experienced everywhere in the East.
Under the direction of church leader Brigham Young, Mormon missionaries converted thousands, mostly in Europe, and most would make the long trek to the mountains of Utah.
What they talked about is a mountain refuge. They sang songs that said things like, "O ye mountains high, where the clear blue sky arches over the vales of the free," and saw these mountains as a protector of their freedoms, as a protector of their opportunity to build society in the way that they wanted it to be.
They are eager to learn. They want to excel. I think these are traits which are typical for this group of people who left Europe.
Many of those same ethics are reflected in Salt Lake City today. One of the fastest growing cities in America, it continues to welcome people from all walks of life and is home to Fortune 500 companies, a prestigious medical school, an NBA franchise, and now the 2002 Winter Olympics.
We have athletes who come here from 80 nations. They bring their flags, they bring their people, their families, and they participate in one of the greatest events on the world stage. And all these nations and all these people will be welcomed to a place which once was, in some respects, a mountain fortress. And now it becomes a home to the entire world audience.
There are only a few buildings throughout the world that on their own define a culture and a way of life. The Salt Lake City Temple of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints does just that. This magnificent structure was designed and built almost 150 years ago.
The Latter-day Saint pioneers who arrived here beginning in 1847 wrested a city out of a wilderness. And the Salt Lake Temple is the greatest manifestation of that development during the pioneer times.
Church leader Brigham Young envisioned the temple before it was even built. He saw it as both a sacred place of worship and a cornerstone for a new city. He worked with architects and laid out that vision, and in 1853 called on fellow church members to give of their own labor and begin construction.
People who lived in log houses with dirt floors were giving what they could squeeze out of their ordinary living in order to build a structure that seemed to them the nearest representation of a celestial world that they could imagine.
From the nearby mountains, huge blocks of granite weighing up to 5,000 pounds were cut, hauled, and sculpted into place, all by hand. 40 years later, the job was finally finished.
It was a real challenge for them then. It would be a real challenge for us today to find the craftsmen, the number of craftsmen it would take to put that together today. That's almost a lost art at this time.
Today, Temple Square is very much the heart of downtown Salt Lake City. Millions of visitors enter its gates each year, and it is the center of the city's grid system. All streets in the valley are numbered by their distance from the temple. It appears on national magazines and newspapers as an icon of Utah. Yet the temple still functions as it was originally intended to. It is a house of worship, a sacred space, removed from the workaday world of downtown.
A temple is a place that creates sacred space through the sacrifice of the people who build that temple. And in that sacred space, it's possible to have more clear and direct communication with God. And so the idea that there needs to be holy space or sacred space is very fundamental to Mormonism.
But perhaps the Salt Lake Temple is best described as a symbol of a worldwide faith based in a city that will welcome the world in 2002.
A woman was home Friday night with her fiancé and young niece when a stray bullet killed her. Police say 34-year-old Lisa Payne was in the bedroom of the apartment on Forest Brook Drive when someone in the parking lot opened fire. Bullets hit several apartments, including Payne's. Medics pronounced her dead at the scene. Police say they do not have any suspects, but they are now looking for the victim's brother. They say Bruce Minter lived with Payne. He left the apartment to go to the store, and they haven't seen him since then. Police say this doesn't mean they believe he had anything to do with the shooting. They just want to find him.
Obviously, they are concerned. They've had extreme tragedy. They've lost a daughter, and now they can't find their son, so they are obviously upset. So that's why we're asking the community for the help.
Now, if you have any information about this crime, police ask you to call this number for Crime Stoppers. It's 704-334-1600.
A fight between neighbors ended in gunfire this morning in East Charlotte. Police were called to Dinglewood Avenue shortly after 9 a.m. Neighbors say a fight inside a home spilled out onto the street where one neighbor pulled a shotgun on another. One person was shot in the arm and abdomen and should be okay. Witnesses say there were plenty of children around during the shooting. No word yet on any charges.
Charlotte-Mecklenburg police are investigating a double shooting that happened overnight in East Charlotte. Investigators say the two victims were shot at the Highlander Trace apartment complex on Glenfiddich Drive. Prior to the shooting, they'd been at a club on Statesville Avenue. Police say the victims told them there was an argument at the club. Someone followed them home to the apartments. When they got out of their car, they say someone drove up, shot them, and drove away. One was shot in the torso, the other in the leg. Emergency crews took both men to the hospital.
Wednesday, just after 12:30 in the morning, police responded to this home in North Charlotte. A teenager was shot and later died at Carolina's Medical Center. The young girl was 16-year-old Elaine Monger.
This is just a total senseless shame.
Arnell Greenberg was Monger's fifth grade teacher at David Cox Elementary. She remembers Elaine fondly. She says she was always laughing and was very talented.
She starred in our fifth grade opera, and she was in chorus and a dancer.
Had an amazing voice, probably what I remember most about her, and just her contagious laugh and just a bubbly personality.
Youth pastor Damon Stalvey says Elaine was involved in church activities here at University City United Methodist Church, where a memorial service was held Friday.
She has been on some mission trips with us in the past in the summers, went to Tennessee with us and worked with some at-risk kids.
Now Stalvey is helping her family get through this difficult time.
They're struggling, like any family would.
Monger would have begun her junior year at North Mecklenburg High School this week. Lisa Reyes, News 14 Carolina.